Hello everybody, this is Ultimate Lifeform RB, and welcome to a special extra video for the Super Paper Mario playthrough. Now in our last episode, we actually finished off the main part of this playthrough by completing the story, but I did decide to do an extra video because there is some side content as well as some post-game content that I feel deserves to be talked about, and I decided to cram it into one video. Now, we're starting off this video with a special cutscene that plays after you boot your save file for the first time after beating the game. Basically, it consists of Merlin congratulating you on a job well done before asking about Tippy, because when you beat the story of the game, you actually lose access to Tippy, because at the end of the story, she reunites with Count Black, and they go off to live the rest of their lives together. However, even though you lose Tippy, you can regain her abilities, and that's actually the first thing we're going to cover in this extra video once we get through this cutscene. One thing I can talk about before we actually get to it is that in order to do what I'm about to show off, you need to have collected 999 coins. That is the maximum amount of coins you can have in this game, and you're going to need every one of those 999 coins to do what I'm going to show off. There are some good ways you can build up coins quickly, like buying shroom shakes and baking them into something that's more valuable, and then selling them to quickly get some coins. Once you have 999 coins, you'll want to return to Chapter 3. Specifically, you'll want to go to 3-4, because we're actually going to pay a visit to our old friend Francis. You may remember Francis, he was the main villain of Chapter 3. He was the nerdy chameleon who collected nerdy stuff. Sounds like someone I know. And he actually kidnapped Tippy, and we had to fight him in order to rescue her. So it's pretty fitting that we have to visit Francis to get our replacement for Tippy. Although you're about to see an unintentional scene here. If you try to enter Francis's room as somebody other than Peach, you'll get this reminder: Master Francis and Totally Hot Babes only, and you will get a laser blast for your trouble. The only way to turn off the laser is to leave the room and then come back. So I find it pretty interesting that even after beating the chapter, you still kind of have to follow the rules of it a little bit by switching to Peach so you can actually get into Francis's room. So we're going to go ahead and do that. Hey Francis, I got your Totally Hot Babe right here. One that completely destroyed your computer. I mean, anybody remember that little mini game from the end of Chapter 3? Anyway, we gotta talk to our old buddy here. And as he explains, holding a digital butterfly against her will landed him in the hospital, but he's gonna channel his inner nerd, and he's actually gonna put his nerdiness to productive use. So let's go ahead and see his little creation. I should point out this is all post-commentary over-edited footage. And here we go! This is our replacement for Tippy, or as Francis describes it, a one-to-one scale replica of Tippy with real fluttering action. Or as he calls her, Tiptron. Although what's interesting about Tiptron here is that because of her programming, as she says right here, she says her name is Tippy. The thing about her programming is that she is programmed to be like Tippy, but there are hints in her dialogue that she realizes that she's an artificial pixel and not the real Tippy. Now, this is where the 999 coins comes in, because Francis here is actually willing to sell Tiptron to us. So, let's pony up the dough and close the deal, which I am going to do. I'll take you up on your sweet deal, Mr. Francis. So here we go. Here is our replacement for Tippy in the post-game. Tiptron is ours. Tippy's robotic replica. And other than, you know, her some of her dialogue, and what's interesting is that her text box is shaped differently. So it's a subtle thing to point out, but still, you know, she's Tippy, but she's not quite Tippy. Now, Tiptron functions identically. You can still point the Wiimote at the screen and highlight things, and Tiptron will tell you about them. But this dialogue right here is interesting, because Tiptron says, "He constructed me," and then she backpedals it and tries to deny it. So despite being, you know, a replica of Tippy, there is that little hint that she kind of realizes she's a robot, and it's kind of conflicting with her programming to have Tippy's personality. Another interesting thing you can do with Tiptron, another nifty little cutscene, is you can return to meet Merlin in Flipside, and this little cutscene will play out where Merlin will at first assume that it is the real Tippy, but that notion will quickly be disproven, thanks to your character explaining the situation. You're one of Francis's creations. Tippy was loved by many, wasn't she? Well, do take good care of this one. That we will, Merlin, and that's pretty much it for all the stuff with Tiptron. I thought it would be good to show off. It's not strictly required. However, the next thing we are going to cover does require Tippy's abilities, depending on how you go about unlocking it. And if you wait until the post-game to attempt this, you will need Tiptron. So, the next thing we're going to cover is the Pit of 100 Trials. Now, the Pit of 100 Trials originates in Paper Mario The Thousand Year Door for the GameCube, and it's expanded upon a little bit in this game by virtue of the fact that there's more than one. Now, as the name implies, the Pit of 100 Trials requires you to go through 100 rooms filled with enemies to reach the end. You can actually access the Flipside Pit of 100 Trials as early as Chapter 2, when you get Boomer, because you need Boomer to break some blocks over a pipe, which I just did. Although you are going to see me screw around a little bit here, because I notice a little indent in the wall, and of course, being the curious person that I am, I'm going to check it out by flipping into 3D. You don't really get anything out of this except a chest containing a card. So back to the subject at hand here with the Pit of 100 Trials. I let myself get sidetracked. There are actually two Pits of 100 Trials, one in Flipside, one in Flopside. We'll worry about the one in Flopside a little bit later. We're going to focus on the one in Flipside. And there actually is more than one method of accessing the Pits of 100 Trials. The method I'm showing off here is the one that you have to attempt if you try to do it earlier in the game. There is an alternate way, but in order to do it, you basically have to wait until you've done Chapter 7 towards the end of the game when you have Luigi. Now, using the pointing powers of Tippy slash Tiptron, you need to cause blocks to appear in order to reach the large platform that will actually take you to the entrance of the pit. So now that we've done so, we can go ahead and, you know, do like you always do in a Mario game, put those platforming skills to use, and of course you're going to have to flip into 3D. Now, if you haven't already unlocked the Pit of 100 Trials after going this way, you should come across a blue switch. Hitting that switch will open the wall and you'll actually be able to enter the pit. Alternatively, if you have Luigi, you don't have to go through the path that I took. You can simply take a more direct route and then use Luigi's super jump to get on top of the wall and hit the switch. But unlocking the pit is only half the battle. Now we have to actually attempt it. I am going to show off at least a little bit of it. When I was gathering footage, I didn't go through the whole thing. I went through enough that I thought would be good enough to illustrate my point that I'm trying to make. Now, again, this is optional content. Everything I'm showing off is basically optional for the most part. You do not have to go through the Pits of 100 Trials to beat the game. There are some nice bonuses and collectibles you can get, but you don't need to do this to beat the story. Although it is a good source of experience because of the sheer number of enemies you're going to be defeating over the course of the trial. I recommend having your levels near end game, maybe even higher than the levels I had at the end of my playthrough. And you're also going to want to stock up on some healing items in order to, you know, make your journey a little bit more bearable. Now, not only do you have to defeat enemies in the Pit of 100 Trials, going through all the rooms, you also have to collect a key. It's, from my memory, it varies which enemy has a key depending on, you know, from run to run, the enemy that holds a key is going to vary. You may notice a timer on the screen. There is a 5-minute time limit in each room throughout the Pit of 100 Trials. If that timer runs out and you don't have the key and you haven't gotten to the door, you instantly die. It's a game over. And depending on when you've saved, that might set you back far. So be sure to save your game before attempting the 100 Trials to make sure you don't lose progress. Now, every 10th room, as in room 20, room 30, etc., you'll come across a room that contains a large chest. Each chest contains one character card, and in the flip side Pit of 100 Trials, each card is of the pixel characters of this game. Occasionally, there will also be an item vendor. But probably the most important thing is this pipe. You can leave the pit with this pipe, but as the dialogue box says, it's a one-way pipe. So if you leave, you have to go through the entire pit from the very beginning. So yes, it's one of those things. Once you start this gauntlet, you pretty much have to go through to the beginning. From the beginning to the end, I should say. Now, when you reach the end of the flipside pit, you will come across Racktail. Racktail is a special bonus boss. He's basically a recoloring of Fractail, the first boss of the game from Chapter 1, and he's defeated in much the same manner. You pick up the little minions crawling along his back, and then you hit the antenna on his head. He's fought the same way, he just has more HP. You know, it's the video game trope of an earlier boss being recolored and stuff and used as a boss later in the game, in this case as a bonus boss. Now, defeating Racktail will earn you a special pixel named Dashel. Dashel is an optional pixel, and when he's equipped, he will allow your characters to move much faster than normal. It's a nice ability, but again, it's not required to beat the game. But we're not done talking about the Pits of 100 Trials yet. Now it's time to talk about the Flopside Pit. Now, the Flopside Pit, you can pretty much use the same methods to unlock it. You can take the long way around through the outskirts of Flopside, or once again you can take a more direct route and use Luigi to super jump on top of the wall and hit the blue switch. Now you are going to see me screw around a little bit here too, because I kind of think maybe there's something else hidden I can find, but not really. Now, a note about the Pits of 100 Trials is that I don't really have any footage of me going through the Flopside Pit, because I'll go ahead and say it right now. In order to access the Flopside Pit, you have to beat the Flipside Pit first. So it's one of those things where you have to beat one to unlock the other. I did manage to find a screenshot inside the Flopside Pit of 100 Trials, because there are a couple notable differences between the two pits. And one that is going to be showcased right now is that, much like the Flipside Pit, you have to use Tippy / Tiptron's pointing ability to make platforms appear, but there's a twist to this one. For this one, the platforms will be moving, which I think is an actually pretty interesting touch, because it's kind of letting you know that the Flopside Pit is going to be more difficult than the Flipside Pit, because think about it. You access the Flipside Pit by jumping across stationary platforms. To get to the Flopside Pit, at least on this route that I'm taking, you have to jump across moving platforms, which are generally going to be more difficult than stationary platforms. I mean, it's a small thing, and maybe I'm reading too much into it, but I still think it's a pretty good it's a pretty good thing to give you a sense that you're going to be in for a more difficult challenge. Now, you may notice that there's no blue switch here, even though the door, or the wall rather, is not open. That's because, again, I haven't beaten the flip side pit, so I can't access the flop side pit. And again, of course, you can use Luigi's Super Jump to take a more direct route. Now, another notable difference in the flop side pit of 100 Trials is that all the enemies are dark versions, which I'm assuming would mean they're tougher than their normal counterparts. Another thing to note is that in order to access the boss of this pit, you have to go through it twice. So it should really be called the flop side pit of 200 Trials. You also get character cards from the treasure chests in this one, and they actually depict the party members from the original Paper Mario on the N64, which is a pretty nice callback to that game. But anyway, on to the boss. The boss is Shadou. Shadou takes on dark silhouette forms of the four heroes. Each form has 100 HP, and you have to defeat all four, which combines to 400 HP, which makes Shadou the toughest boss in the game in terms of health. Once you beat him, you get two very nice bonuses. You get character cards of the four heroes and their shadow forms. You also get infinite flip for Mario, so you can stay in 3D without having to worry about a meter, and you get doubled attack power for all the heroes. But again, much like Deschel in the flip side pit, all these prizes are purely optional, but they are nice to have nonetheless. Now, the final thing I want to talk about is actually something that we saw in the main part of the playthrough. In Samus Kingdom Chapter 6, we took on the Duel of 100, but it got cut short because of the storyline. And, you know, Samus Kingdom got destroyed, but in the post-game, Samus Kingdom has been restored, and you can actually go through Chapter 6 as a full chapter, as in four parts, instead of just two like in the main storyline. And the Duel of 100 is basically like we saw in the main playthrough. You go through 100 rooms, taking on different opponents, each getting tougher as the challenge goes on. They each have their own different attack patterns and stuff to keep you on your toes. And you do get a prize for going through the Duel of 100. You get more character cards, but this time the cards will depict the party members from Paper Mario The Thousand Year Door. So they do have callbacks to both of the previous Paper Mario games that came before this one. Now, I'm gonna say right now, don't really expect me to go through the pits or the Duel of 100. I really don't have the desire or the will to really go through them because, you know, it's optional stuff. And really, it's the end of the game. Is infinite flip really going to do me that much good, or double attack power? Not really, to be perfectly honest. I mean, the game's already been beaten for the most part. Maybe if I could figure out something for like a live stream, you know, do like a live stream of me going through the pits or the Duel of 100. If I could ever make that work, maybe then you might see me do full runs of those on my channel. But really, for the most part, I just wanted to briefly talk about these things, you know, in an extra video. I say briefly when this video is over 20 minutes long, but still. I thought it would be a good idea to at least discuss some of the side content and not leave some threads hanging and stuff. But that was pretty much all I really wanted to cover in this video, you know, getting Tiptron, going through the pits of 100 Trials, and talking about the Duel of 100, which you can attempt in full after you beat the story of the game. And that's essentially it, folks. That's pretty much it for this extra video of the Super Paper Mario playthrough. In the last episode, which was the finale of the whole thing, basically, I already gave my thoughts and my post-mortem on this playthrough, but to repeat some of those thoughts, I did enjoy doing this game for this playthrough. I really do like this game. It is one of my favorites of the Wii. And the door is open to tackle some of the other Paper Mario games in the future. Most likely, the original Paper Mario on the N64. So if anyone out there enjoyed this playthrough and you would like to see me attempt other Paper Marios, you know, be sure to speak up because the door is open for those in the future. But anyway, that's it for this extra video. This is Ultimate Lifeform RB signing out, and I will see all of you in the next video.